Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Christ Memorial. We're so glad you're all here to worship with us. We'll go ahead and please stand, and we're going to begin our worship.
Good morning. It is so good to see you. Welcome to Christ Memorial. Go ahead and have a seat. It is great to see you today. Those of you who are here in person or as well as those watching online, it is great to have you. If you're watching online live via Facebook, be sure to share that post so that others can join in. Couple of announcements to lead us off today. First of all, I would be remiss if I didn't mention it's somebody's anniversary over here. Pam and Luke, happy anniversary. There's no song we can sing to embarrass you, but you know, whatever. And then secondly, you'll notice a large gathering of folks right over here. You can tell they're Lutheran school teachers because the front row is also reserved for them, but they didn't sit in the front row. It's okay. No, we are glad to have our school teachers joining us from our preschool here. We're going to be celebrating them a little bit later on in the service, but welcome to you guys. Also, we have our new member class that started today. You can still kind of jump in midstream, even if you're already a member and you're like, why would I do a new member class? It's a great opportunity to kind of refresh on the foundational beliefs that we have in the church. So you can do that. That is in between services every Sunday, so you can jump into that. We also have our regular Sunday Bible studies happening. We have the discipleship class with Pastor Jason. as well as Bruce Kuhn's leading a Revelation study. I got to tell you guys, it has been a very interesting morning. My wife, she's actually on a plane finally to California. She's speaking at Concordia University Irvine, her alma mater, to speak about Gen Z, but her Uber was like half an hour late. So, and then I guess apparently Houston Airport, not great to get through for security, so I was frantic about that. But then this morning I get here, and apparently Pastor Jason and I both wrote a sermon for today. So you're going to get two sermons. It's fine.
Yeah, all right.
They're only about 45 minutes each or so. So, you know, get real comfy. You'll be really glad we have cushioned pews today. No, Pastor Jason was graciously flexible, and he'll be preaching his next week. So, but thank you for that. With that said, hey, I know I just had you sit down because of the announcements, but let's stand back up because we're going to call upon the presence. Look at you guys like, I don't want to stand. We're going to call upon the presence of God, and we had to do so standing, and so we do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let's worship together.
Set free, oh, I am set free, oh.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the freedom that you give us, for that love, for that grace. Help us to be gracious, to be graceful in all that we have and all that we do, recognizing the blessings that you give to us every day. In your name, amen. Amen. You can have a seat, and I promise I'll let you stay seated this time. You know, as we were singing that song, I Am Set Free, I don't know why, but I was reminded of, I have this friend, she works down at the Dolphin Research Center, just outside of Key West in Florida. And they have natural pools that the dolphins swim around in, and that's where they feed them and everything. Well, they tell the story of there was a hurricane that came through, and it raised the sea level rather significantly. And they sent some people out to check on the dolphins, and they found that those natural areas that the dolphins swam in were completely submerged. It was just an open ocean at that point. But they found that the dolphins were still swimming in the same spot that those pools were, that they had just gotten so used to being in those pools. And they, of course, knew where their nourishment comes from. But that idea that even though they were free, they were still swimming in those same pools reminds me of this song, I Am Set Free, and our own view of sin, that we've been set free from being captive to sin. We've been set free from this captivity that we have towards the lies of this world. We know that God has set us free, and yet we just keep swimming in the same pattern. We keep living in the same spot. But we get the opportunity here today to break free, to go to God with that sin, to go to God with the rebellion that we have in our lives, the way that we live that is contrary to what he designed. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in the sermon. But let's take that moment here today, whether in person or online. Let's go to him and bring that confession, to bring our sin, bring that guilt and that shame, those things that you have tucked away in the back of your proverbial closet, that you're so afraid of people finding out about. Like, bring it to God. He's ready to listen. He's ready to ease your burden. He's ready to forgive you. Let's take a moment now, just you and your Heavenly Father, to bring that sin to him. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you as a broken people, people who came in here full of sin, full of brokenness, shame, pain, guilt. Lord, give us the strength to recognize that sin, to take that long, hard look inward, and to bring our mistakes, to bring our rebellion, to bring our wrongdoings and lay them at your feet, knowing that you'll take them. You'll take them away, that you will forgive us. And so we ask that forgiveness and grace and mercy would wash over us and make us new again. In your name we pray. Amen. See, the reason that we come to church isn't so that we have, you know, a fun time, get some kolaches. It's not so we come and sing some great music. It's not so that we can see our friends. The reason we come to church is for forgiveness. That nowhere else will offer you true and authentic forgiveness and love that won't fade away. Because the good news of our God is that he already knew about all that guilt and shame. He knew about that skeleton in your closet, and yet he still loves you. It's with that love in mind that I have the privilege and honor to say to you here today, your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. With that new freedom, with that new life that we have, let's praise God together as we continue to worship.
Precious compassion that pours from the wounds that have won our salvation. Sin was strong, but the Savior is strong. from the wounds that have won our salvation. Sin was strong, but the Savior is stronger. Come, let us worship Him.
The first reading is from Acts chapter 3, verses 11 through 21, and can be found on page 911 of your pew Bible. While he clung to Peter and John, all the people, utterly astounded, ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you denied the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be granted to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given the man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all the things about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago." The epistle reading is from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, and can be found on page 1022 of your pew Bible. "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous."
Please stand to honor the words of the Holy Gospel. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he said this, he showed him his hands and his feet. And while they were still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. And he took it and ate before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father before you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." We now join together in a creed, a statement of our belief, our credo, that we have, that we share not just with ourselves, not just with the Lutheran Church, but the whole church throughout all time. And so now we confess that faith together, confessing, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." You guys can go ahead and have a seat as I invite our kids up for our kids' message. I know some of you are out there. If you're like, I don't know, like 8 or younger, I don't know, Pastor Jason, maybe we'll make an exception for you. Yeah. Come on up, guys. Come on up. All right, we got the Parker and Leland show today. That's all right. All right. I'm going to set this over here. Parker, I asked you beforehand if I could pick on you a little bit, and you said no. But guess what? I'm going to pick on you anyway. Could you do me a favor and stand up? Just stand up. Do you like candy? Hey, there we go. We got some more folks. Come on up. Have a seat. Have a seat. Do you like candy, Parker? You guys can have a seat. You got just there. You go. You're good. All right. Do you like candy? All right. So I have had a piece of candy. Hold on. It came out of the wrapper. It's a little linty. That's all right. You can just rinse it off for later. All right. Did not mean for that to happen. All right. So I've got a piece. Do you like Jolly Ranchers? They're all right. Yeah. Pretty good. I'm gonna set this Jolly Rancher right here. And if you could do me a favor and step onto the top step there. So if I told you don't take that Jolly Rancher, pretty easy, right? All these people are looking at you. But maybe if there weren't all these people looking at you, you'd be a little more tempted to take that Jolly Rancher, right? So here's what I want you to do. I want you to turn and face the opposite direction away from the Jolly Rancher. You can't even see the Jolly Rancher. It's not a temptation at all, right? Give me a head nod. Very good. So when you're facing away from this thing, it's a lot less tempting. See, God sometimes tells us to face away from our temptations. We're going to be talking about that in the sermon today. But I think part of the reason that this Jolly Rancher isn't so tempting to you is that it's covered in jacket fuzz. And because it's a green apple Jolly Rancher, which is the worst flavor of Jolly Rancher. Whoa, I didn't know that was controversial. Team Blue Raspberry, okay? All right. So, but Parker, here's the deal. You have here, this represents, don't look yet, keep looking that way. This represents the temptations of the world. The things that you might want to do, like not listen to your parents, or like not clean your room. You go in there and you like clean one thing, you find a hat, you put the hat on, you're like, we're in a hat now. We all do it. I'm 35 and I still do it. So this represents all the sin, but here's the thing. God's told you to turn away from that. It's called repent. But you know, I know something cool, Parker. Could you do me a favor and walk over to the pulpit there, the big stand? To the left. Here, I'll help you. Right over here. Come over here. And look right in here. What are you seeing there? A lot more candy, right? Yes. That's right. A lot better candy. Come on, this one doesn't have jacket fuzz on it. All right, so here's the deal. God told you to turn away from the Jolly Rancher that you knew was there. It was kind of covered in jacket fuzz, but was there, and it was something that sounded good, but God had something so much better in the direction he wanted you to face, right? That's kind of like how God wants us to face away from the sin of the world and instead look towards his way. And maybe we can't see it. Maybe we didn't even know it was there, but he has so much more for you. And you guys are all just completely listening to me right now because I have my hands full of candy. I was going to give this to you, but I may have to hold it during the sermon so they'll pay attention to me. All right. You know what? Parents, I am so sorry. Here you go. Here are some Starbursts. You like Skittles? Or you prefer Starbursts? Good Skittles? Okay, good. Here you go. Pick something out of there. Boom. Starburst, good choice. All right, let's pray. Oh, does anybody want the Jolly Rancher? Jason, there you go. It truly is covered in jacket fuzz. Please wash that off first. Let's pray. But here's the deal. When I pray, with these guys at least, you're not going to start off like this, right? You're going to start off with your hands in the air. Get those hands in the air. You guys think you're way too cool for this. That's okay. Keep your hands in the air. And then we go like this. Boom! Fold your fingers. Bow your head. That's a sign of respect. Close your eyes. And repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for today. For bringing us here and for the chance to worship. Help us to face towards you, to trust you, and to follow you. Thank you, God, for loving us, and help us to share that love with everyone. Thank you, God. And all God's people say, eh. You gotta say it with me, eh. I'm not done yet, eh. Keep going, eh. Amen. Amen. Thank you guys so much. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. Take your candy with you. You guys can have a seat. They're gonna preach the sermon today. Let's go ahead and continue to worship. Thank you.
sing of his faithfulness, pouring his life out unto death.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Welcome again, and welcome to those watching online. If you guys will join me in prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for today, for this chance we get to come together and worship you, whether here in person or online. Lord, I pray that you would focus our hearts, focus our minds on you. Lord, I thank you for the chance to share your message. Let it be your message. Let it be from you, about you. Move me out of the way. I submit myself to you, and I pray that everybody who hears this message would come to do the same, that your Holy Spirit would be at work, proclaiming your love and your truth. In your name, amen. You sinners, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. Amen. Some of you are thinking, boy, what was Jason's sermon? That sounds a lot better. Wow. So I'm sure all of you at some point have heard something along those lines, usually from somebody standing on a street corner, right, with a megaphone outside of a sporting event or a concert or something like that. They've got a big sign, maybe on a college campus. That's pretty popular. That's popular on TikTok as they film those and kind of mock them. They got their bullhorn, and they're telling people how they're terrible sinners. And every time that I encounter one that preaches like that, one of these sidewalk preachers, I've heard a couple from the pulpit, actually, to be completely honest with you. Every time I hear it, it makes my skin crawl. I just, like, my blood boils, like, you are not helping right now. Because it's coming from this place of condemnation and anger, and the tone is such that it just accuses, right? But if you're paying attention during our readings, we heard the word repent a good number of times. And if you look throughout the Bible, repent is said hundreds of times. In fact, when Jesus goes to preach to the people, what he preaches, according to the scripture, is repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So how is it possible that Jesus, who his whole thing, his whole ministry, his whole identity is wrapped up in being loving and compassionate and empathetic and just this amazing example of how to be loving to your neighbor, how is Jesus throwing out this word repent that we see as aggressive and potentially even slightly offensive, right? I think it comes down to a misunderstanding of what that word and that concept means. And so I really started wrestling with this. Like, okay, what does it mean to repent? In the Old Testament, there are a number of Hebrew words that are kind of translated to repent. And generally they mean, like you saw during the children's message, turn away from. To turn away from sin, right? To repent, to turn away. In the New Testament, the word is actually metanoia in Greek, metanoia, which meta means change or new, right? Metamorphosis. And then noia means mind or thought. That's where we get paranoia from, right? So metanoia, a new thought, a new mind. It literally is changing your mind. That is what it means to repent. And so when you look at those Old Testament definitions and this idea of a new thinking, it becomes just reality that in the biblical sense, to repent is to turn away from the sin of this world, to turn away from the lies and the deceptions, from the temptations that you see in this world. So then the question becomes, how do we get this idea of judgment and this accusatory nature of the word repent? How do we get this modern connotation of repent being something that's like, whoa, 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 settle down here, fire and brimstone? I think it comes from actually a misunderstanding of sin and not fully understanding what sin is all about. Because when you try and take repentance, which is something that's truly biblical, this idea of turning away from sin, turning away from the ways that we are supposed to live, because, I mean, like, God designed this world, so he knows how it's supposed to go. When you take that biblical concept and you try and make it corporate, you try and make it something that, say, the church can control, you get into some hairy issues. This is still prevalent in many church bodies. Probably the most common and yet far from alone is the Catholic Church. Because here's the idea. Okay, imagine like this is a timeline, like your day. This is when you wake up in the morning, and then over here is where you fall asleep. And everything in between, that is your day. So imagine, if you will, this is when you wake up, that alarm on your phone goes off, and instantly your mind goes, OMG, I am so tired. Well, there you go, sin number one, right there. You're barely even awake, you've already broken the second commandment, Lord's name in vain. That's okay, that's just the first sin. You got a whole day ahead of you, right? Well, then immediately you grab that phone, and what do? You gotta check those emails, right? You gotta go through your to-do list and see what you gotta get to done today. Well, that's breaking the first commandment in some ways, right? Putting your work before God, right? Have no other gods before him. Maybe spend some time in prayer thanking God for, hey, I woke up today. That's pretty cool. So there's sin number two. Then like here, okay, you leave the house and, well, we live in Houston and there's traffic. So there's at least 9 or 10 sins right here. Just really dense I-10. Then we come over here and there's like that one person at work that just drives you crazy. A couple sins there, and we get to the end of the day and, well, a couple sins there. And you start to look up and they all start to add up, right? And what you see, and kind of the belief, at least technically within the Catholic Church, within a number of other church bodies, is that you have to ask for forgiveness for each of these sins, the 9 or 10 here in I-10. You have to ask for forgiveness for each of those. And it's just like you see in the movies, right? You go into the little room and there's a little screen there and you're like, forgive me, Father, for I've sinned. And he's sitting on the other side like, what'd you do this time? And you're like, well, here's what happened. And what happens though, because this is something I teach middle school theology, and one of the questions they ask a lot is, what if I forget a sin? What if, like, I'm going through and I remember everything here and I remember everything here, but like there's this one thing here that I forgot. What happens if you forget a sin? Well, see, the issue is, you're making sin like a checklist. You're making it an achievement in terms of forgiveness. You're saying, okay, I gotta ask for forgiveness for this one, ask for forgiveness for this one, and so on and such forth. But the Lutheran understanding is, yes, there are little check marks of sin that we committed throughout the course of the day, but the bigger issue is everything from here to there is just sinful. Like, we live in a state of sin. We say that in our nature, we are sinful, because even, you know, you saw during the children's message, there's this temptation, this pull away from God. Naturally, we are not people that follow God's way. We may work pretty hard to do it, but the real issue is that we at our very core are just sinful people. That's why in our confession earlier, right, we didn't go through and like enumerate each sin. You didn't have to sit there. I only gave you 10 seconds. So it's not like you could be like, oh, and I did this, and then I did that, and oh, this one's gonna take a long time. Like, I didn't give you very long, so it's not about enumerating each sin, because here's why. If that's the case, if you have to ask for forgiveness for each sin, then your forgiveness is contingent upon you and you remembering it. But our forgiveness comes from God alone. In fact, in the Lutheran Church, we have some Latin phrases, which is weird because that's usually more the Catholic Church, but we have sola gratia, sola fide, and solus Christus, which means grace alone, faith alone, in Christ alone. In other words, we are forgiven by God's grace, a free gift, full stop. That is how we are forgiven, not by anything that we do, not because we check off the checklist of, oh, I got to stop by the priest and do my private confession. It is by grace alone and by faith alone that isn't even ours. Like, the Holy Spirit gives us that. And then lastly, it comes only through Jesus Christ. So we are given this forgiveness, and it's not about us. I think the issue is that repentance becomes kind of muddied with the concept of salvation. Let me explain. There's a verse, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Let me say that again, but breaking it down. The Lord is not slow, so not slow, quick. He is quick in keeping his promise. What is God's promise? Forgiveness and salvation for his people, to redeem us. We see that all the way back in Genesis chapter 3, where he makes a promise, he makes a covenant with Eve, and he says that your offspring will overcome the serpent. That's his promise to us. He is quick in keeping his promise, but he is patient with us. Okay. In the Lutheran church, we have two $10 words, justification and sanctification. Justification, that is the forgiveness of our sins. Justification is what gets us into heaven. That is our salvation. And our salvation is quick, and it happens like that right there on the cross. Our salvation, our justification happens through Jesus, and we have nothing to do with it. But the second word, that's sanctification. That is that lifelong process to get back on the path of God. That lifelong struggle that we have to pursue the way of God, the way that we are supposed to be living, because here's the thing. Here is the reality. We are sinful people. Every last person on this planet. We're all broken. And this world that we live in is broken because of it. It does not take more than 2 minutes on the local news to see just how broken we are. It seems like every time you turn on the TV, there's another mass shooting. There's another racial tension. There's another moment of hate. It does not take long to see the pain and the sorrow and the suffering and the brokenness of this world. And we, all people, are the reason for it because we just keep breaking things. And yet, through our lives, through trying to be more and more like Jesus, to try and follow the way that God meant when he designed this world, we are growing ever closer to him. We're growing ever closer to not hurting others, to not hurting ourselves, to not hurting our God. And it is a struggle. It is incredibly difficult. But we know that God is patient with us. And he knows. If you heard my Easter sermon, it is a lifelong thing. The faith that we have isn't just the opening of our eyes. Oh, wow, I'm a Christian now. My life is all great. No, it is the dawn coming, slowly creeping over the horizon, and you realize, wow, my life is getting lighter and lighter. Teachers, you guys know that you have that one, maybe six students in your class that just drive you batty. I don't know if any one of them is in this room. Leland, how you doing over there? I'm just kidding, he's great. But you have that kid in your class that there's that one moment that they make the right decision. And you're just like, yes! And then they immediately do something else and you're like, uh-oh. But that one moment is just glorious. You're like, maybe they're getting it. Because they were nice to this kid once, it's just this amazing celebration, this aha moment. That's how God is towards us. He looks at us and is like, ah, my problem child, all of you. You got it for even just a moment, and it makes him so proud. He is so patient with us. He is so loving towards us. And it can be difficult when we hear this imperative of repent, because, you know, partly because we're Americans and we don't like being told what to do, right? But we're told to repent. And it's for our own good. I'm reminded when I was a little kid, I was going to visit my dad at his office. And it was a big, big storm outside. And I was going up the stairs. And I got to the little landing as the stairs turned and went the other way. And I looked out the window and the sky was green. And some of you are going to know what that means. Suddenly my dad comes bounding down the stairs and grabs me and pulls me the other way. And we lock ourselves into like the boardroom on the lower floor because there was a tornado. Destroyed most of the building. But see, if I was unaware and I was just walking along and all the conditions were fine and somebody came and grabbed me and pulled me into that boardroom, I'd be like, what is going on? Who do you think you are? But because I trusted that it was my dad, that he had the right thing in mind for me, I knew that he had me go a different direction than the way I was going. I just had to trust. And so when God speaks to you and says, Yeah, repent, turn away, have a new mind, a metanoia. Know that he has your best interest at heart. He knows what is best for you. Let me say this very simply. We're broken. We are. And we cause pain to people around us, to ourselves, through our rebellion. And we need to be saved. We need eternal salvation. And that only comes through Jesus Christ, only. There's no other way. You can't earn it. But we have a God who knows us so much, who loves us so much, that he's willing to pay that price to give us that salvation. And my friends, now that we have been set free, we have a challenge. We have a challenge as people who are walking on the path of God to stay on the path of God, to bring others to the path of God, to let others know about the hope that is found in Jesus Christ. We have a challenge, and it is going to be a challenge. Because naturally within us is this sinful and broken nature. But we have to respond to that challenge because there are people who don't know about love and forgiveness, who are trying so hard to eat that piece of Jolly Rancher covered in jacket fuzz, and that's the only nourishment they have. We have the responsibility, the calling, and the challenge to say there's so much more waiting for you. You just have to trust. So my friends, my brothers and sisters in Christ, may we respond to that challenge. May we live our lives truly seeking to repent, to have a new mind, to follow God. And yes, maybe you don't see where it's going yet, but you just have to trust. I pray that we have the strength and the courage to repent. Because God is with us. He will never leave us or forsake us. We repent because the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Amen? Amen. Amen. Now, if you could please join me in prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for who you are, for what you have offered to us. Lord, I pray that you would continue to remind us of the love that we have in you. Remind us of the path that you have laid out for us in love, that it's not restrictive, it's not something that we should buck against, but instead it's the right way for us. Lord, you've never given up on us. You've not given up on this world. You've not given up on your people, your children. You've not given up on your creation. And so we pray that we wouldn't give up on ourselves. Inspire us, Lord, to follow you and to bring others onto that path. That they would know that there is so much more, that there is hope, and that there is a love that will never fade away. And Lord, because we live in a broken world, we raise up the brokenness. We raise up those who are experiencing the conflict of this world, who are experiencing the pain and the sorrow, the hatred. We ask that you would help them to know that they are loved, even as the world may look down on them, that they are loved by you, their heavenly Father. And Lord, help us to be that love, to proclaim that love to the people that feel hated. And Lord, in our midst, in our care, in our congregation, in our community, there are those who have requested prayers. And so we pray for Jessica Calhoun, who is traveling, is now on bed rest and during pregnancy. We pray for relief of tension in that situation and for her husband who is serving this country and the difficulty that's involved there. Lord, we pray for the joyful anniversary of Pam and Luke, that they would be able to celebrate and celebrate the love that you give them. Lord, we pray for all those who are affected by COVID still, as it seems like we're nearing the end with the gift of that vaccination, but it's still prevalent. And so we ask that you are at work in the doctors and the nurses. Help us to be compassionate to the people around us. And Lord, we also raise up the family and friends of Lowell Kirkpatrick, who's a longtime member here at Christ Memorial, who has been involved in starting worship and at Eagles Trace, among other places, who now gets to be in worship with you, who has gone home, Lord. And so we thank you for that. But we also pray that bittersweet prayer for his family and friends as they are able to celebrate his life this coming Wednesday here at Christ Memorial 11:30. Lord, we ask that you would inspire us ever on to point more and more people so that when we pass away, that others can celebrate our lives, but more than that, can celebrate the eternal life that we have in you. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for all you have done. In your name we pray, amen. I'm now going to invite our teachers to come on forward. I know you guys love that. Come on up, guys. You're all looking at me like, oh, please no. Here's what we're going to do. We're coming on up here and line up facing this way along these steps here and just kind of figure out. I mean, you guys are teachers. You know how to arrange yourselves. Just pretend you're preschoolers. You can figure out where to stand. All right. Keep your fingers out of your noses. I've seen how the preschool chapel goes. You got to keep fingers out of noses, okay? All right. And you can do like multiple layers there. You can step up on the next step there so that we can fit you all. We don't need everybody bunching down over yonder. So here, those of you who are here as part of the church, Monday through Friday, we have this amazing ministry that occurs just 50 feet from here. And actually sometimes in this room. Where there is love and compassion, there is the love of Christ that is shared with, how many, what is our number right now of students?
192.
192 little dudes and dudettes, as well as their families. And they get to hear about the gospel. They get to see the gospel modeled through these amazing teachers. I was a teacher for like 4 months, and these guys are superheroes. Because I dealt with middle schoolers, which is its own problem. They're dealing with preschoolers. That's ridiculous. So here's what we're going to do. We are going to say a prayer for them. We also, after the service, out there somewhere in that direction, there are gifts for you guys. We got you guys some little gifts as our appreciation for you because of all that you do for the ministry, for this community, for Christ Memorial at large. So let's go ahead and pray for these guys here. Lord God, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for these teachers who are willing to be here today, but also be here Monday through Friday, be here for those kids. Lord, we thank you for the love that you've given them, the love that they can share, that setting that example so early in those young lives, showing truth, showing compassion, showing mercy and grace, showing how to keep fingers out of noses. That's important too. So Lord, we thank you. We thank you for their sacrifice, for their work, and we pray that you continue to bless them and that they could be a blessing to others, be a blessing to this community, be a blessing to this church. And we pray that you would inspire us, that you would challenge us to be a blessing to them as well. We thank you for all that they bring, for all that you give them, and for all the from you that they give out. In your name we pray, amen. Let's give a big hand for our teachers. Truly, you guys are absolutely incredible, and I got to tell you, the way you guys run car circle out there, I want you to run more things in my life, because you got that thing like a well-oiled machine. Every time I go out there, I'm like, I'm just in the way. I'm going to get out of the way. So with that said, thank you guys so much for all that you do in the school and in the community. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We love you. We love you. Thank you. You guys can go ahead and have a seat, except for when you get there, don't sit down, because I'm going to have everybody else stand up. Come on, stand up. It's the last song. You can't take it sitting down. All right. We're going to, once they get back to their seats, we are going to join together in the Lord's Prayer, and then we will close out our worship today with our closing song. Let's pray the prayer that Jesus himself taught us, praying together as one voice, one family of believers, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Am I supposed to do the blessing right now? Okay, let's do a blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you, smile when he looks at you. And may he give you the peace that comes with knowing that you are a beloved child of God. In his name, amen. Let's worship.
All hail.
so much for being here today. Thank you to Luke and the band. Happy anniversary again. Teachers, when you go out there to the back, stick around, because the church would love to thank you for everything that you do. So folks, stop by, say thank you to them. Hey, have a great week, everybody. Enjoy.